Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Failure to Disrupt: Why Technology Alone Can't Transform Education by Justin Reich. Narrated by Eric Michael Summerer. Prologue. I am reviewing the copy-edited manuscript of a book about technology and learning just as a pandemic has spread across the globe. By the time you download these words onto your favorite screen, or, I pray, walk into your local bookstore to pick up a copy, the world will be different. Schools and colleges are among the most durable and conservative of our social institutions. They prepare people for the future by connecting them with knowledge and wisdom from the past. Faculty make some accommodations for changing times, but for the most part, instructors teach how they were taught. Schools hold fast. Even during history's watersheds, they hold fast. My colleagues in higher education are right now, for the most part, trying to teach as they did before, using video conferencing software to continue broadcasting their lectures. Most elementary school teachers have quickly and wisely given up on continuing a typical spring progression and shifted to enrichment, providing web links and worksheet packets that families can do at home to stay busy. Secondary school teachers are somewhere in between. These heroic, hasty efforts by teachers are working unevenly. In educational institutions serving affluent students, where instructors can assume that students all own their own devices, have access to sufficient broadband, and live in homes stable enough to weather a global recession, things are proceeding reasonably well. Not so for schools that serve rural families and poor urban neighborhoods, or for community colleges, state institutions, and for-profit colleges serving working adults. In these settings, the best efforts of teachers are being overwhelmed by the barriers of technology access, employment disruption, hunger, homelessness, stress, and disease. Many things that happen in schools simply cannot happen at a distance. In one of the first American news articles about the shift to online learning, a parent lamented that his 6-year-old required full-time supervision to participate in the remote instruction being offered by his first-grade teacher. That anyone, a parent, a first-grade teacher, a school principal, a journalist, would expect a 6-year-old to have the self-control, motivation, and attention span to participate in remote instruction is strange, yet typical of our extraordinary expectations for the power of learning technologies. It should not be a surprise that a 6-year-old would need direct, physical, human co-presence to participate in schooling. It is more surprising that so many people might be led to believe otherwise. In the early days of a lost semester, students, parents, and teachers are rapidly discovering the possibilities and limits of distance learning technologies. In the dark days of quarantine, technology provides some light for learning. Mo Willems, the brilliant children's book author, is broadcasting weekly lessons about reading, writing, and drawing. Vast numbers of online courses and textbooks from massive open online course, MOOC, providers, and open educational resource repositories are providing useful support to self-paced learning, especially for older learners. As children miss months of school, the loss of math instruction is one area where students face lasting detrimental effects on academic progress. And by good fortune, adaptive math learning software is one of the most well-developed categories in the field of education technology. For all these bright points, however, it is also obvious that the gains of learning technologies are substantially offset by the loss of schools as places for camaraderie, shelter, nutrition, social services, teaching, and learning. When all the bars closed, people could still find companions and dates, even against CDC recommendations, on Tinder, Bumble, and Grindr. If the printing presses were to stop, people could still get their news online. But parents, students, administrators, governments, and pundits who thought that schools could simply pivot to online learning and finish out the semester are learning in the early days of the pandemic that the social and social service functions of schools are intimately tied to their learning outcomes. In what follows, I attempt to explain why learning technologies work in some situations but not others, and for some people but not others. I hope that the explanations that I developed in a period of relative stability provide some insight in the wake of a terrible pandemic. I hope it becomes clear why a steady drumbeat of techno-optimism about learning technology over the last decade might lead people to believe that a first-grade teacher could remotely instruct 20 or so six-year-olds. I expect that the world will still be wrestling with COVID-19 as this book is released, and I hope that what follows can help educators and the public understand the places where learning technologies are most likely to be of service. We will have much to rebuild, and perhaps learning technology can help. But online learning won't be an effective replacement for our old system. Rather, the best possible future will be one where we recognize the incredible importance of our formal education systems to the social order, and we provide these systems with adequate funding, support, and respect. Our learning technologies are only as strong as the communities of educators who guide their use. J.R., March 21st, 2020. Introduction. Education Technology's Unrequited Disruption. The must-have toy of the 2013 holiday season was Rainbow Loom. A simple plastic board with vertical pegs, Rainbow Loom came packaged with hundreds of small, colorful rubber bands that children could weave across the pegs to make bracelets and charms. Press coverage celebrated Rainbow Loom as a back-to-basics craft toy. The Toronto Star reported that parents loved the toy because it's simple, it doesn't require a battery, it doesn't mean more screen time, and it isn't an app. The article quoted industry expert Jim Silver. It's an activity. You can sit down and create. Parents also like it when they show creativity. And you're not done playing with it because you can wear it. In an era when iPads and smartphones were ascendant, Santa brought millions of children a toy that would finally get kids to put down those damned devices. Except it didn't. Rainbow Loom wasn't an antidote to screens. Rather, screens were integral to playing with the loom. Because some of the things children could make with Rainbow Loom were quite intricate, the easiest way to learn a new design was through a video tutorial. In 2013, two girls, Ashley from Pennsylvania and Steph from Ohio, published a 16-minute video demonstrating how to use Rainbow Loom to make a Starburst bracelet, an intricate, three-dimensional display of color and technique. To make the video, they mounted the camera in a stationary position above the Rainbow Loom, which they placed on the carpet. As Ashley carefully demonstrates to viewers the process of weaving each band, the video moves slowly through new techniques and speeds up through repetitive motions. Within 2 years, the video had been viewed more than 30 million times. The very first Rainbow Loom videos were created by the niece and daughters of Cheong Chun Ing, the inventor of the loom. Ing recognized early on that teaching and learning would be essential to the marketing and success of his crafty new toy. After kids had made all the bracelets specified in the printed instructions that came with a kit, they could continue to discover new possibilities by searching for videos posted online by people who had invented their own creations. Ing turned to his kids to help. The problem was that people didn't understand how the looms worked, so I asked my niece and my daughters to create YouTube videos explaining how to make rubber band bracelets. These created a trend. In a quintessential example of what media scholar Henry Jenkins calls the participatory culture of the internet, many other children and aficionados followed suit. They shared videos, asked questions, offered hints, started discussion forums, posted pictures on Facebook, and sold bracelets through online stores and websites. Together, these rainbow loomers formed what cultural anthropologist Mizuko Ito calls affinity networks, online communities of enthusiasts who connect with each other around interests and hobbies for learning, camaraderie, support, and critique. Running alongside the global supply chains that delivered rainbow loom kits under millions of Christmas trees in 2013 was an extraordinary, organic, almost instantaneous global network of teachers and learners sharing ideas, designs, and techniques. For those with access to global online networks, now is the greatest time in history to be a learner. Never before have learners had such incredible access to resources and communities of tutors and apprentices. Whether they want to learn to play guitar, brew beer, identify birds, translate Cicero, throw a javelin, intubate a trauma victim, integrate a function, detonate a bomb, program in JavaScript, or become a better teacher, there are online classes, tutorials, forums, and networks full of people who are excited to teach and excited to learn. If you've ever signed up for an online class, downloaded an educational app, or watched a video about how to unclog a toilet, you are part of that network. Bold, unfulfilled predictions. The first two decades of the 21st century brought dramatic changes in informal learning practices alongside other major social changes powered by ubiquitous connectivity and mobile devices. Journalism experienced a flourishing of new voices through blogging and social media, and also a collapse of local news as traditional ad revenue sources moved to internet behemoths. Streaming technologies transformed music and entertainment industries. Dating apps spawned new courtship rituals, and social networking sites redefined the word friend. Against this backdrop of rapid social change, education technologists and reformers imagined a dramatic transformation in formal education institutions. In 2008, Harvard Business School professor Clayton Christensen, with colleagues Michael Horn and Curtis Johnson, published Disrupting Class, a book about online learning and the future of K-12 schools. They predicted that by 2019, half of all middle and high school courses would be replaced by online options, and the cost will be one-third of today's costs, and the courses will be much better. These dramatic changes would be driven by innovators in education technology, or edtech. One such educator, though he was not identified by name in Disrupting Class, was Salman Khan, who in 2008 founded Khan Academy with a collection of short videos explaining math concepts, which he later augmented with an extensive collection of online practice problems and introductory videos in many other subjects. In a 2011 TED Talk, Let's Use Video to Reinvent Education, Khan described a future in which students proceed through foundational content online at their own pace, freeing up teachers to provide intensive remediation or facilitate sophisticated group projects. As his vision captured the attention of popular media, Wired, Time, and Forbes all featured Khan on their covers. A typical headline read, "One Man, One Computer, 10 Million Students, How Khan Academy is Reinventing Education." Khan published a book, The One World Schoolhouse, Education Reimagined, and founded a brick-and-mortar school, the Khan Lab School in Mountain View, California, to test and demonstrate his transformational ideas. This rhetoric of disruption, transformation, and renewal was heard in higher education as well, sparked by the emergence of massive open online courses, MOOCs. In 2011, Peter Norvig and Sebastian Thrun, researchers affiliated with Google and Stanford, offered an online course called Introduction to Artificial Intelligence. The course consisted of short online videos interspersed with practice problems, a model inspired by Khan Academy. When over 160,000 learners signed up to participate in the course, elite higher education institutions took notice and began embracing online learning with staggering speed. Stanford faculty created the for-profit MOOC providers Coursera and Udacity, while Harvard and MIT created the nonprofit MOOC provider edX. As millions signed up for the first offerings from these institutions, MOOC providers promised a radical reconfiguration of higher education, and a New York Times headline called 2012 the Year of the MOOC. That article summed up the vision. The shimmery hope, it explained, is that free courses can bring the best education in the world to the most remote corners of the planet, help people in their careers, and expand intellectual and personal networks. In August 2013, Udacity co-founder Sebastian Thrun talked about the prospect of offering powerful learning experiences at low cost and global scale, and he made a confident declaration. "The thing I'm insanely proud of right now is I think we've found the magic formula." Thrun was in the vanguard of MOOC enthusiasm, but he was also one of the first to dramatically revise his expectations. 3 months later, in November 2013, Thrun declared in another interview that MOOCs hadn't accomplished what he had hoped. "We were on the front pages of newspapers and magazines, and at the same time I was realizing we don't educate people as others wished or as I wished. We have a lousy product." In the years that followed, other edtech evangelists also displayed more chastened expectations. Millions of people have watched Khan's 2 TED Talks, but I suspect that far fewer have read his 2019 interview with District Administration, a trade magazine for school superintendents and central office staff. "Now that I run a school," he told the newspaper, "I see that some of the stuff is not as easy to accomplish compared to how it sounds theoretically." Khan's recommendations in 2019 focused less on disruptive transformations of math education and more on using Khan Academy as a modest supplement to traditional classroom instruction. More recently, we're seeing that if students put 30 minutes to an hour per week, or one class period per week, toward software-based, self-paced learning, schools will see a 20 to 30% greater than expected gain on state assessments. "That's exciting because that's a dosage that's very doable in mainstream classrooms. We tell schools to give students 30 to 60 minutes of Khan Academy per week, with teachers doing traditional curriculum 4 days per week." When Khan's soaring vision met the complex reality of schools, disruption and transformation gave way to accommodation. The blended model that Khan espoused in District Administration is actually at least 25 years old. In 1997, Ken Kadinger and colleagues published Intelligent Tutoring Goes to the Big City, a report describing the use of adaptive, self-paced algebra tutoring software in the Pittsburgh public schools. Students learned in traditional settings for most of their class time and then spent about 1 day a week using math tutoring software, which led to improvements on math tests similar to what Khan would find decades later. Much of what Khan Academy discovered by 2019 about computer-assisted math instruction, after more than $100 million in philanthropic investment, could have been found in academic papers published in the 1990s. Genres and dilemmas. In the decades ahead, educators can expect to hear a new generation of product pitches about the transformative potential of new technologies for school systems. How artificial intelligence or virtual reality or brain scanners are the innovations that, this time, will actually lead to profound changes in education. These pitches will also be wrong. These new technologies will not reinvent existing school systems, though some of them may make valuable incremental improvements. And this book is an effort to explain why. I have two main arguments corresponding to the two sections of this book. First, new technologies in education are not, in fact, wholly new. They build on a long history of education innovations. Second, there are certain basic obstacles that time and time again have tripped up the introduction of large-scale learning systems. A few words about each of these arguments will help to preview the territory the book will cover. Regarding the history of new technologies, from the earliest days of computing, back when mainframes took up entire rooms, technologists have tried to use these new machines for teaching and learning. The project of teaching people with computers is at least 60 years old as digital computing itself. If you know something about this history, you can look at a new technology, trace its lineage, and make well-informed predictions about how a new iteration will contribute to existing educational systems. In exploring this history, I'll focus on technologies for learning at scale, learning environments with many, many learners and few experts to guide them. Whereas some technologies, like a calculator, easily fit into the existing structure of schools, large-scale learning technologies are the ones that reformers most often turn to when they imagine widespread transformation of educational systems. These tools are sometimes used entirely online, but they are also blended in countless ways with on-campus learning communities in classrooms, schools, and universities. Online platforms that can be used by millions of learners independently fit squarely within the definition of learning at scale. But so can tools that attempt to individualize learning in a classroom or substantially reshape the experience in a large lecture class. I primarily study how these emerging large-scale learning technologies intersect with existing educational systems, but I remain keenly interested in interest-driven learning outside of schools and what schools can glean from the experiences of rainbow loomers and other participants in online affinity networks. Large-scale learning environments can be classified into three genres based on the answer to a key question: who creates the activity sequence for learners? Because a sequence can be created by an instructor, as in the case of MOOCs, by an algorithm, as in the case of adaptive tutoring software, or by a peer, as in the case of distributed learning networks. There are instructor-guided, algorithm-guided, and peer-guided large-scale learning technologies. Each of these genres has a history, a research literature, and a track record of success and failures in formal educational institutions. If you can figure out into which of these categories a new large-scale learning technology fits, you can do two useful things. First, based on the prior performance of similar approaches, you can make predictions about what outcomes will emerge as new technologies are integrated into complex systems of schooling. Second, understanding what is old and recycled can throw into relief what is genuinely innovative in a new product or approach. Identifying the modest innovations in emerging technologies can help predict how a new offering might offer some incremental improvement over past efforts. Turning to the second argument, the histories of technologies in all these genres reveal some common challenges that have consistently hindered efforts at improving learning through education technology. In part two of this book, I identify four kinds of obstacles that large-scale learning systems have encountered repeatedly over recent decades, which I call as-yet-intractable dilemmas: the curse of the familiar, the EdTech Matthew effect, the trap of routine assessment, and the toxic power of data and experiments. These patterns help explain why predictions for transformative change have fallen flat, and examining these dilemmas is critical for looking forward. These four dilemmas comprise a set of grand challenges that designers, researchers, and educators need to overcome if education technology is to make learning faster, cheaper, more enjoyable, more effective, and more accessible for people around the world. New technologies alone will not sweep away these dilemmas, because the challenges of learning at scale are not merely technical in nature. In his ethnographic study, Life in Classrooms, Philip Jackson offers a memorable observation. The path of educational progress more closely resembles the flight of a butterfly than the flight of a bullet. For engineers, sometimes more is just better. A bigger explosion in the chamber leads to a faster bullet. More fuel burned makes rockets fly faster. As historian Larry Cuban argues, education is not just complicated but complex. It is an interlocking system of learners, educators, technologies, and broader social contexts with all kinds of invisible linkages and unexpected consequences. Trying to accelerate learning by ramping up technology is like putting rockets on butterfly wings. More force does not lead linearly to more progress. Educational systems are political institutions negotiated by a diverse set of stakeholders: teachers, students, families, communities, school boards, trustees, vendors, state and federal governments, and others. They exist to serve a variety of sometimes conflicting purposes: preparing people for civil society, training workers for employment, sorting and ranking students into a social hierarchy, developing moral character, providing breakfast and lunch while parents are working, and on and on. Technologists often assume that their creations can reconfigure or bypass these complex systems, but instead, they discover that school cultures, in words that I and Mizuko Ito have used before, domesticate new technologies. Rather than upending existing educational systems, new technologies get put to work serving some particular niche in schools or universities. In the second half of this book, I argue that the most promising approaches to learning at scale combine technical innovations with efforts to improve these complex systems. EdTech charismatics, skeptics, and tinkerers. In The Charisma Machine, anthropologist Morgan Ames contrasts two approaches to applying emerging technology to improve learning. There are charismatic initiatives that envision sweeping change. Her case example is the One Laptop Per Child project launched in 2002, and ascribe tremendous power to new technologies to reinvent education. In the 2000s and 2010s, evangelizing technologists often adopted the rhetoric of disruptive innovation to describe how emerging technologies can offer a new value proposition that leads to the wholesale transformation of existing systems. One way to look at the TED conference is as an annual revival meeting for charismatic technologists. Reading transcripts from TED Talks about educational topics is a reliable research strategy for finding unfulfilled predictions about education technology over the last decade. The disruption of schools promised by education technology advocates in the first 20 years of the 21st century has been universally unrequited. One opposing position to the charismatic stance is skepticism. And education technology has a rich tradition of critique that designers and educators should take seriously. But there is another alternative position to the charismatic, tinkering, a term drawn by Ames from David Tyack and Larry Cuban's history of K-12 schooling in the United States, tinkering toward utopia. Tinkerers see schools and universities as complex systems that can be improved, but they believe that major improvement is the product of many years of incremental changes to existing institutions, rather than the result of one stroke of wholesale renewal. Tinkerers study past efforts at educational reform to avoid replicating past mistakes. Tinkerers harbor an optimism that technology can be used to improve teaching and learning, but they embrace research and critique as a crucial check against utopian thinking. Charismatic technologists orchestrate boom and bust hype cycles, cajoling local systems into making major changes and then moving on when transformation proves elusive. Tinkerers persist much longer with their designs, their partners, and their communities. Tinkering offers a middle way between the charismatic and the skeptical. This book is a tinkerer's guide to learning at scale. For classroom instructors, school technologists, department chairs, and administrators, the history of learning at scale provides valuable guidance in selecting and tinkering with implementation of new learning technologies. For technology developers and researchers, investigating the persistent challenges faced by education technologists over the last two decades reveals important avenues for new research and development. Understanding how technologies are being adopted to improve schooling and lifelong learning empowers parents and citizens to influence the public educational systems in which all of us have a stake. A Tinkerer's Career in Education Technology. I came to tinkering with education technology through classroom teaching. In 2003, I took my first full-time teaching job in a private school south of Boston, where I taught ninth grade world history. In the corner of my classroom was a cart of blue and orange clamshell MacBooks loaded with web browsers and an intranet application suite called First Class that offered a server-based version of just about everything that Google Suite for Education now offers through the cloud. To help the school figure out what networked learning might look like, my world history class was part of a test program in which I was expected to use the laptops every day. I loved it. Archives, governments, and museums around the world were in the midst of a massive campaign of digitizing historical material. With colleagues, we completely redesigned our world history syllabus from a traditional survey class to one in which we investigated contemporary world conflicts through journalism and then traced the peoples involved back into ancient and medieval history. My students explored primary sources available online, and they developed and demonstrated their understanding not only through traditional assignments such as essays, but also through new media including blogs and podcasts. In a place with extremely privileged access to resources, hardware, software, networks, and support staff, and well-prepared students, I found teaching with technology to be incredibly energizing for me and for my students. I went on to co-found a consultancy, EdTech Teacher, to help schools implement digital learning. In this work, I visited with faculty and school administrators from hundreds of schools across the United States and around the world. I joined a doctoral program in 2008 and studied how social media and peer production tools like blogs and wikis were finding new uses in K-12 classrooms. I graduated right before the founding of edX, and I was the first full-time researcher hired by Harvard to develop the infrastructure for researching edX MOOCs. From my office next to the video producers and project managers who developed Harvard's first edX courses, I tried to study the enterprise as both an insider and an outsider, close enough to the action to understand some of its inner workings, yet distant enough to make a concerted effort at objective analysis. Eventually, I united my interests in online learning and professional development for educators, and I now run a lab at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, MIT, called the Teaching Systems Lab, where we aspire to design, implement, and research the future of online learning for K-12 teachers. An oddity of my career is that I am an education technologist who often writes about how education technology fails to deliver on its promises. In 2009, around the same time that Clayton Christensen and his colleagues published Disrupting Class, I wrote a report on education technology for a short-lived British enterprise, Beyond Current Horizons, a website published by the United Kingdom's Department of Children, Schools, and Families. I predicted that technology would lead to only minimal or superficial changes in school practices. I saw no evidence that EdTech advocates had any plans to provide the substantial investment in professional learning that teachers would need to incorporate new technologies in powerful ways. 4 years later, on my first day at work at Harvard X, I published a blog post at Education Week with a prediction. I think it's probably more likely that most MOOCs end up being talking textbooks with auto-graded worksheets, useful in some particular circumstances with particular populations, but, like every previous generation of education technology, ultimately a disappointment. And my deepest concern is that the people who will benefit from these new initiatives are those who already are privileged and advantaged. In this book, as in my past writing, I try to maintain humility when approaching the challenges of improving school systems and to show deep respect for the teachers and professors who work heroically every day to maintain the daily work of existing schools. In the face of these challenges, three ideas have sustained my interests in tinkering with technology in schools. The first is that the needs are vast. We will soon have 8 billion people in the world, and as many of them as possible should have the benefits of education. Over 200 million people in any given year access higher education, but many millions more dream of the opportunity. Nearly a quarter of all students in schools serving America's poorest children have no access to a calculus course. Large-scale learning cannot serve all learners in all places, but we should find the places where technology can expand educational opportunities or improve learning. Second, when online learning works well, it is beautiful. I love meeting students who found a new path in life after taking a MOOC or discovering an online community. I love meeting educators whose ideas about learning and instructional design were challenged and reshaped by encounters with online tools. I enjoy watching my own young daughters explore the world of learning online. My second grader's passion for math is currently being nurtured by a flashcard app, and although I hope it is not the only way she experiences math and technology at school, I am grateful that she has the opportunity to enjoy the rewards of practice, repetition, and advancement. I think the app she has is a little better than the flashcards I used as a kid, and incremental changes of these kinds are meaningful. As my colleague Ken Kadinger says, a step change is just 20 years of incremental change as viewed from a distance. Finally, and most importantly, I remain convinced that even though technology alone will not disrupt systems, technology can abet system change. Emerging technologies help learners, educators, and other stakeholders encounter new possibilities, and they loosen the grip of education's conservatism. They invite questions about what might be possible if we rearranged curricula, schedules, goals, assessments, and other key features of educational systems to allow emerging technologies to provide more utility and opportunity. Technology will not dissolve the stubborn challenges of education, but designed thoughtfully and implemented reflectively, learning at scale technologies can help. The chapters that follow are my effort to share the most important lessons I have learned about tinkering with technology in the service of improving educational systems. 1. Three genres of learning at scale: instructor-guided, algorithm-guided, and peer-guided. 1. Instructor-guided learning at scale: massive open online courses. In 2011, Peter Norvig and Sebastian Thrun, computer scientists affiliated with Stanford and Google, emailed 1,000 affiliates of the Association for the Advancement of Artificial Intelligence announcing a new, free online course, Introduction to Artificial Intelligence. The course mirrored the residential class offered to Stanford students, with videos of Norvig and Thrun talking over their computer screens as they wrote snippets of code, math equations, and bullet points of important ideas. Interspersed among these videos were multiple-choice quizzes and short computer programming assignments, which were submitted online and graded by computer. People from 190 countries signed up for the offering, and 23,000 people completed the course. This startling demand for a university-level computer science class immediately prompted other courses with huge public enrollments. Stanford computer science professors launched three classes in machine learning, artificial intelligence, and databases, and each had more than 100,000 enrollees. At MIT, Anant Agarwal created a new platform called MITx and offered his own course, Circuits and Electronics, that gathered more than 150,000 registrants. The courses became known as Massive Open Online Courses, or MOOCs, a term coined several years earlier by a group of Canadian educators experimenting with distributed learning models. Venture capitalists in Silicon Valley took note of the emerging opportunity, and they provided seed funding for several online learning startups, among them Udacity and Coursera. Harvard and MIT invested $60 million to create a nonprofit alternative called edX, and they created new provost-level enterprises to lead online learning initiatives. For higher education observers used to the glacial movement of universities, these institutional changes appeared with blistering speed. Online courses had been well established in higher education long before these events. At the turn of the millennium, 8% of undergraduates took at least one of their classes through distance education, primarily at non-selective colleges and for-profit universities. Elite institutions, too, dabbled in online learning throughout this period. By 2012, faculty at Harvard and other institutions could put new MOOCs on edX relatively quickly because of the school's existing, largely unheralded, investments in digital learning. In its first year, HarvardX was able to launch 6 courses in computer science, political philosophy, public health, ancient history, and law, because many of the faculty involved in these enterprises were already conducting online courses in their own schools and scholarly societies, or through Harvard's Extension School. Perhaps the most immediate change sparked by MOOCs was social rather than educational. With the blessing of Ivy League universities, online learning switched from low status to high status almost overnight. Universities that bragged about how many students they rejected in each admissions cycle began to compete for how many students they could enroll online. In 2013, soon after finishing my doctorate, I joined Harvard X as its first full-time research scientist, the Richard L. Menschel Harvard X Research Fellow. I was physically close to the teams developing MOOCs, but organizationally removed, managed by faculty on the newly created Research Committee for the Office of the Vice Provost for Advances in Learning, rather than by the Harvard X executive staff. My tasks were to study the enterprise, develop the infrastructure for conducting research on edX courses, verifying data packages from edX, defining measures and metrics, and creating surveys, publish research and reports, and advise stakeholders. The perspective on these initiatives offered here is my own. It is not the official position of either Harvard or MIT. Three big bets for MOOCs. In the months that followed the founding of edX, Coursera, and Udacity, MOOC advocates offered a set of dramatic claims, three big bets, about how MOOCs would revolutionize higher education and lifelong learning. The first big bet was that MOOCs would transform the delivery model of higher education, led by a new generation of online providers. In early 2013, Clayton Christensen, a Harvard Business School professor known for his theory of disruptive innovation, warned that within 15 years, maybe half the universities would be in bankruptcy. The concern was that every local college's introduction to biology course would be replaced by one or two Bio 101 courses taught by rockstar super professors from elite universities. As digital providers and their partners created these mega courses across the curriculum, the economies of scale afforded by giant courses would allow them to be better and cheaper than anything a local institution could offer. Sebastian Thrun from Udacity speculated that in 50 years, there might be only 10 institutions of higher education left, and Udacity could be one of them. The second big bet was that MOOCs would dramatically expand global access to higher education. In her 2012 TED Talk, Coursera co-founder Daphne Koller described her mission as creating the best courses from the best instructors from the best universities, and providing it to everyone in the world for free. Her idea was that Coursera would host free online course material and charge a small fee to anyone who wished to receive an official certificate of completion upon successfully passing a course. Learners could get a valuable new kind of credential associated with the prestige of elite universities, while Coursera minted millions for investors and university partners. Students in the far reaches of the world without access to traditional higher education would join working professionals who were too busy to return to school full-time in creating a massive new population of online learners. The third big bet was that through research and continuous iteration, these new online courses would provide more engaging and effective learning experiences. The long, droning lectures of university faculty would be replaced with short, snappy videos interspersed with active learning exercises. The vast behavioral data generated by online learning platforms would fuel new research into the fundamentals of human learning. The resulting insights would then be applied to further improve instructional design. Kohler imagined that MOOCs would turn the study of human learning from the hypothesis-driven mode to the data-driven mode, a transformation that, for example, has revolutionized biology. Together, these three bets proposed a future in which MOOCs would sweep away all the inefficiencies of a legacy system of colleges and universities. Higher education researchers sometimes describe the challenges of improving post-secondary education by referring to the iron triangle of cost, access, and quality. Efforts on one side, to reduce cost, broaden access, or improve quality, generally have a negative impact on at least one of the other two sides. The promise of MOOCs was that they could have positive effects on all three sides. Costs would go down as expensive faculty labor was reduced with digitized lectures and computational assessment. Access would increase because learners would not need to pass bureaucratic barriers, pay high fees, or even be physically present in a classroom. Quality would improve as a result of technological innovation and partnerships with elite institutions. These dramatic changes have not come to pass. Instead of transforming higher education, MOOCs have been absorbed by the existing higher education system. They are now primarily supplements to existing infrastructure for professional master's degrees and executive education programs. Understanding why these three big predictions didn't pan out and what was accomplished requires drilling down into the pedagogical and technological foundation of MOOCs to reveal their capacities and limits. New technologies, old pedagogies. Given the breathless enthusiasm with which new learning technologies are introduced, one of the most useful dispositions in evaluating edtech is to regularly ask the question, what's really new here? Most components of new products and systems have a long history, and only occasionally do new entrants offer a genuinely novel innovation. To evaluate how MOOCs tried to revolutionize higher education, the first step is to explore what was old and what was new. When Thrun and Norvig were developing Introduction to Artificial Intelligence, one of their most important influences was Khan Academy. In the mid-2000s, Salman Khan, working as a senior analyst at a Boston hedge fund, started making a series of video tutorials about mathematics for his young cousin in Louisiana. The aesthetics of the videos were simple. Khan drew equations and notes on a black screen with a baritone voiceover describing what he was doing and why. Viewers never saw Khan's face. The focus was on the math. Khan Academy's platform includes both instructional videos and practice problems. But in the early 2010s, these learning resources were separated from one another. Videos on one part of Khan's website and practice problems on another. The Introduction to Artificial Intelligence course, by contrast, interleaved video tutorials with practice problems. Like Khan, Norvig and Thrun talked through a segment of content with a video lasting 5 to 10 minutes. Unlike Khan Academy, after a video, they presented their students with a few practice problems to answer, mostly multiple choice or short answer questions. After several of these lessons, students completed longer programming assignments that were submitted online. A computer program graded them based on whether the programs accomplished the engineering tasks for the assignment. When students ran into questions or difficulties, a discussion forum provided a space for learners to gather and answer each other's questions. This general format was replicated in Andrew Ng's first Coursera course on machine learning and in Anant Agarwal's first MITx course on circuits and electronics. This lecture-based pedagogical approach goes back millennia. To a first approximation, there are only two primary approaches to teaching and learning. As Plutarch wrote in On Listening in the 1st century CE, education is not the filling of a pail, but the lighting of a fire. Of course, theories of learning and instruction can be infinitely more complex than this simple dichotomy, but these two perspectives of pail filling and fire lighting appear in various guises throughout the history of schooling and learning. Summarizing these two ideas in the American context, historian Ellen Lagerman argued, "One cannot understand the history of education in the United States during the 20th century unless one realizes that Edward L. Thorndike won and John Dewey lost." In 20th century America, philosopher John Dewey became the patron saint of the firelighters. Dewey famously argued, "I believe that education, therefore, is a process of living and not a preparation for future living." And he advocated for an approach to education that emphasized apprenticeship, interdisciplinary learning, and connections to the world beyond schools. Social constructivism, The idea that individuals construct new understandings from prior understandings in the context of learning communities is one term used by education researchers to capture this family of pedagogies. Edward Thorndike is less well known than Dewey, but his approach to education will be recognizable readily. Thorndike believed that education could be organized as a science, in the positivist traditions that shaped sociology, political science, economics, and other social sciences. Thorndike believed that learning could be precisely measured, and he was an early developer and advocate of standardized tests and intelligence testing. With these measures of learning, best practices in the direct transfer from experts to novices could be standardized and scientifically evaluated. No single term captures all of the pail-filling intellectual descendants of Thorndike's thinking, but instructionism is a useful label for these ideas. MOOC developers have been overwhelmingly instructionists. New learning technologies rarely innovate on these fundamental pedagogical ideas. Instead, they reenact them. Educators and researchers who had been conducting online courses since the 1980s noted that few new MOOCs offered an improved pedagogical experience for distance learners. Most courses simply recorded a professor lecturing, hearkening back to the earliest days of motion pictures, when the first order of business was the filming of stage plays. MOOC advocates place their big bets on innovation in distribution rather than innovations in teaching and pedagogy. But even MOOC technologies for online dissemination had well-established histories. The key components of MOOCs: learning management systems, storefronts, and autograders. The fundamental technologies supporting edX, Coursera, Udacity, and other MOOC providers was the Learning Management System, LMS, a platform on which instructors could arrange and deliver learning resources to learners in a sequential order. By 2012, LMSs were widely used throughout higher education, both to make online materials accessible to residential students and to facilitate fully online courses. MOOC platforms added two components on top of these LMSs: storefronts and autograders. Learning management systems. The essential purpose of an LMS is to organize instructional content online. The first cited references to learning management systems appear in scholarly literature in the 1960s and 70s. The first commercially successful LMS was Blackboard, released in 1997, and the first widely adopted open-source LMS was Moodle, released in 2002. The earliest LMSs were dissemination tools that provided a space for storing and distributing syllabi, readings, and other course materials. Over time, they also offered drop boxes, which allow students to upload assignments and instructors to grade and return the work on the site, and discussion forums, which serve as the primary means of peer interaction. Crucially, LMSs provide a set of authoring tools that allow faculty with no programming experience to create course sites. By dragging and dropping content and plugins, and by filling in forms and text boxes, faculty can create a presentable web presence for their courses without writing a single line of HTML, CSS, or JavaScript. Learning management systems are boring. They fall into that class of infrastructure: pipes, wires, roads.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.